This is a question for Keith. The connection of environmental education and international or global student body, how could Olney establish itself as an international environmental education center?
Well, I'm not sure, because this idea was just new to me when I read the sheet of all the wonderful ideas, but I think it's a terrific one. I'm a little cautious about advocating travel. When we did Friends Road College, travel was cheap and students flew around the world at the drop of a hat. That's no longer the case, so you have to have some consideration for that carbon footprint in the way this work is developing. But I had a conversation with Peter Hackbart after the lunch about the fact that he has, and I think I'm quoting him right, he has better conversations with his students who are elsewhere in the world via email communication or Skype than he does perhaps with students that are on campus. So it doesn't require necessarily travel in the way we used to think about it. So I guess using the technologies that we now have is one way that international education can be really well developed while keeping in mind the cost of that international experience in terms of transportation. It's a real dilemma for me, because I'm a great advocate of this kind of international experiential education, but the realities of our climate situation and the need to curtail ourselves on these is a real dilemma, I think, that we're all struggling with.
Hey, add one to that, Keith, and that is that this is the same dilemma we're facing as well, because it's so enriching to go to other cultures and spend time there. But one of the things that I've realized in doing these programs is that American students often are not very adept at dealing with foreign cultures, even though here we are, this melting pot with every culture in the world here. So you don't have to go very far away to go to new cultures and to spend time with people who are different. And I encourage you to do what was it, Thoreau, I think, said that he, somebody asked him if he was a world traveler or something, have you been to England? And he said, no, I haven't, but I've seen a lot of Concord. And I would encourage you to see a lot of Concord.
Here's a question for you, Erik. The motivations for the change to a four-year college, do you see reasons why your school's model cannot work at the secondary school level? And similarly, did Sterling have high school students and gap year college students at the same time? So sort of the ages of the students.
Yes, we even have that now to this day. We have occasionally high school students joining us, or students just coming for a semester and taking a set of classes. I don't think that there's any boundary or anything sacred about whether you're a secondary school or post-secondary, graduate, whatever. I think the commonality is the stage of life that you're at, which is that initial getting, some of you may be familiar with the folk high school programs of Scandinavia and Denmark in particular, and one of the educators there said, my job is to wind students up so tightly that they'll never, like a fine clock, wind them up so tightly they'll never run down again. And that's, I think that's what you share, and that's what you should focus on. That and also one of the founders of those types of schools, a man by the name of Grundtvig, has a wonderful line that I come back to again and again, and that is that no one ever accomplished anything in life that they first did not dream about when they were young. So that focus on that dream, let that dream come alive, because this is the time of your life when that's appropriate and to be welcome.
Here are questions for Leslie. How is ACENet funded? And how does the fee structure work at your central kitchen and your central kitchen and the food ventures system? So more details about the funding and the kitchen.
So ACENet is organized as a nonprofit organization, and our annual budget is primarily based on the rental income that we generate from our five business incubators. We have three business incubators in the city of Athens on our Athens incubator campus, and then we have two facilities in Nelsonville. So the rental income from those five facilities constitutes anywhere from 60 to probably 65% of our annual budget, which typically ranges around $800,000 annually. We also generate fees for services in a variety of other ways. So in some ways, we do a little bit of social enterprise work. We operate three brand programs right now that many of our food entrepreneurs participate in. One is called the 30-mile meal. The other is Food We Love. Those are our two food and farm branding programs. Our third is called Art of Ohio, because we also work with a lot of area craftspeople, artists, and artisans throughout the Appalachian counties. That houses an e-commerce site, and we take a percentage of sales from their e-commerce activity. ACENet, the Food Ventures Center, is still probably, I would say, our highest generating revenue in terms of all our business incubators. The fees in the facility range anywhere from an hourly rate based on what type of equipment and what rooms that you're utilizing. We have a sliding scale because we primarily target low and moderate income entrepreneurs. Some of the rental rates are also based on your family or household income.
This is for Leslie, and other panelists can speak to it as well. How do you address arguments that local or rural people can't afford fresh produce or aren't educated enough to choose it over conventional produce?
I think the organic movement particularly has struggled sometimes with the perception that denser, more nutritious, fresh, certainly certified organic produce needs to cost more. We've done some studies and have gotten some media coverage where we've compared prices in the Athens Walmart, the Athens Kroger, and then what's available through some of the CSAs and certainly at our area farmers markets. And really, there's not a whole lot of difference in pricing. But I think we still have to overcome that perception. A lot of the work that we do in conjunction with another organization called Community Food Initiatives is, I would say, part of the education around the utilization of local food. So it's not just about growing food, but it's having nutrition, food preparation training from really, we have programs now, I think, from the third grade on in a number of the local schools. We work with 4-H clubs, Future Farmers of America programs within some of the area high schools to really learn more about local foods. So I think if you look at, you know, the financial argument, there's a number of ways to really overcome some of that mindset. The other piece is to really look at value for your dollar. So when you think of the caloric intake, I guess, of a Twinkie in comparison to maybe organically prepared salad, you know, the nutritional density, the nutritional value probably is still at a better price range than what you're paying for that Twinkie. We've also really worked with our farmers market associations to encourage them to use what's called the EBT program, WIC coupons, and senior farmers market nutrition program coupons. And those are pretty much available in most of our farmers markets. One of the things, and maybe this sounds a little boastful, but the Athens farmers market, I know last year, had the highest redemption of food stamps in comparison to all 17 farmers markets in the state of Ohio. Our transactions constituted 44% of all the activity. I just got a handout from one of our market managers yesterday when I was at the Athens Farmers Market. And as of the beginning of September, we had about $29,000 in food stamp utilization at the Athens Farmers Market. And since it's a year-round market, we assume that we'll be way over $30,000 this year. So we may be first in Ohio for food stamp redemption again. And I think a lot of this is around education. So that's what we really focus on, and certainly youth education.
Taste testing is a devious way to win kids over, to get them to like beets, and then to go home to mom and say, Mom, can we get some of those beets? I got a good way to do them. So start young.
I suspect that a lot of the price differential that's associated with organic produce is driven by the scale in which that produce is produced. The large organic growers have a strong interest in, and probably necessarily so, because their inputs are very high. If you're at a smaller scale, you probably don't have to look at it quite the same way. You value your labor differently. Small farmers tend to be willing to work in a certain way. They probably have multiple sources of income. So I think the question of this upscale pricing is a difficult one, but it gets more difficult for the larger growers. So that's why the smaller scale is probably better from a standpoint of being affordable for the average person.
For Erik, please speak about your experience recruiting students for work-based education.
Parents are all in favor of the idea. But most of our students come, I would say, in fact, all of them come certainly with a knowledge of us being a work college, and are engaged by it, and they own it. It's their program, and I think very shortly, even the ones who don't own it, and that's occasionally where you have to step in and do some teaching, because there are people who haven't had very good work experiences or haven't been taught some of the subtleties of it. Once they're won over, it's their program, and they will carry it as far as it can go. In terms of recruiting and the discipline of it, I don't think that's a big thing. If you can make work fun and make it interesting to do, the danger, I think, is that you create a monster like we have in some cases, in that, as I've always said, that if I have a student walking across the grounds and there's a gum wrapper lying on the ground and that person says, I'm not picking that up unless I get paid for it, we have created a monster. And so along with the work ethic in the sense of doing the work, you have to get the work, kind of the spiritual ethic as well, of why it's important to pick that up, and that it really only counts if nobody sees you do it. So that would be my response.
How do we create foreign studies for first world students that engage long-term energies to sustainable development in third world economies, rather than simply sensitizing the students? Let me read the question again. It's addressed to Keith and Erik. How do we arrange or establish foreign studies for first world students that engage long-term energies to sustainable development in third world economies? Do you want to see it?
No, but maybe we could have a little interpretation.
No, yeah, the person who wrote the question want to explain it anymore? Oh, sure.